to come here and worship God with us all together. So I welcome you, and I hope we worship God together with a joyful heart, even if this is Lenten period. Actually, Lent is a season of 40 days to counting 40 days up to Easter, but it's not including Sunday. So without Sundays, it's beginning with the Ash Wednesday, 40 days of cleansing time, waiting for the Easter Sunday. Some people prepare to be baptized and also preparing their hearts to bring back to God, repenting, and some people fasting. So many traditions, the Lenten period, people are fasting. And these days, many people modify that, fasting not just for the food, but social media, video games, or Korean drama, anything that you're addicted to. Yeah. So this is cleansing time and sometimes emptying time and filled with the Holy Spirit. We have a few announcements. Easter sunrise service is at 6:30 in the morning, Easter Sunday. The location is 4CMC, and we are having, again, United Choir. And if you're still interested, please join us. And we have Easter Fellowship after the service here at Common Ground. And we had made the announcement last week, the Christian Women's Retreat, surprise, after the registration opened, in one day, all the slots filled. 150 slots, all filled in one day. So that means I would see that lots of women, uniformed women, or family of uniformed women, there is hunger and thirst for spiritual renewal and refreshment. So if you are still interested and also want to support for that retreat, maybe you can wait for opening. And also the other way you can support is you can actually support with your finance, donate, and support that women in the peninsula. We have coffee and donut after service. That's always happiness for me. And anybody new here, first time attending this service? Yes, please. If you don't mind, could you stand up and introduce yourself? Welcome. I couldn't hear clearly, but we have our ushers, so they can bring your gift, and you can leave your information if you want with the ushers. Anybody here first time or last time with the Common Ground service? No? All right. All right, then we're going to, the other thing. Let's stand up and share the peace of Christ. If you're worried about touching, then just remotely say, peace be with you, peace be with you. Or just say hello, and I'm glad that you are here. Let's share our Christ peace. Just for a moment. Peace be with you, fire. Peace be with you, Pastor. We're hearing many bad news every day, war and conflict and fighting, but in the midst of all that chaos, we still give peace to everybody. Peace be with you all. Shalom. Please join me for call to worship by reading Psalm 32. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you at a time of distress. The rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or mule without understanding, whose temper must be cured with being uprooted, else it will not stay near you. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. The Lord forgive us for our lack of hospitality towards strangers. Forgive us for any ways that we make it difficult for new people to find comfortable space in our congregation. Forgive us, Lord, for jealousy and infighting. Teach us, Lord, how to receive people whose sins haven't been made public. Teach us, Lord, how to make our circles large, large enough to include others. And teach us, Lord, how to love each other beyond any faults we may see. Amen.
Please stand with me as we lift our voices in praise to our Father God this morning. The first hymn in the light blue hymnal in the pew in front of you is going to be 431, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Shining in the midst of the darkness, shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth you now bring us, shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father.
Set our hearts on fire.
number 638. I need thee every hour.
Now this is our time to worship God through giving. We have received a lot, and now we're giving a portion of the blessing back to God. Let's pray together. Long-suffering God, we have received or demanded blessings to which we were not entitled. We have also looked out from our place of prosperity and favor and have been indignant over your lavish dispensing of love and mercy. As we bring our gifts this day, we do so in the humble gratitude and recognition that any and all blessings in our life come as your gift of grace. We pray in the name of your greatest gift, Jesus our Redeemer. Amen. this time, let's have a moment of silence and repent our sins before God and ask God's mercy to cleanse our heart and renew with His Spirit. Gracious God, you know the deepest places of our hearts. Forgive us when we forget we are fearfully and wonderfully made, when we pretend you are not at the end of all our searching, when we give ourselves over the other or whatever of our culture. Remind us that your knowledge of us is wondrous and not punitive, and that we are defenseless against your love. Continue to seek us, even as we seek your face. And this time, we're waiting for your touch, your visit in our hearts, and we are waiting for your voice. And please pour your Spirit on Pastor Lee and us. And renew our hearts. We come before you with the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And let us pray as Jesus told us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as you forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and power and glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
this time for our children's church, that's kindergarten to fifth grade, and our youth ministry, that is middle school and high school, to be excused. If the congregation would please sing with me, Jesus Loves Me.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me.
Would you please read for the stand for the reading of God's word from John chapter 3, verses 19 to 21. John writes, "This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be plainly seen that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." The word of the Lord. Thank you. Please have a seat.
Hi, good morning, Common Ground. My name is Jinsup Lee. I'm serving at the 11th Engineer Battalion as a battalion chaplain. It's good to see you Sunday morning. It's always, you know, honor to deliver, you know, God's message to God's people. Amen. I'm going to start with a prayer. Father God, we come before you this morning as you are going to speak through me, challenge our congregation with the word, and be with us. And help us, you know, open our hearts and open our minds to seek your will as we go on to listen to your message this morning, Lord. Lord, we love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Many people are, you know, busy doing their work. Me as a chaplain, I do, you know, all kinds of, you know, ministry as a chaplain at the unit and, you know, come here to, you know, serve our community on, you know, Camp Humphreys. So every day of week, we are busy doing something. I am busy doing my chaplain work and, you know, busy playing, you know, Candy Crush. Nowadays I'm playing, you know, Soda Crush to get, you know, decompress my, you know, stress. But my two boys were, you know, busy doing, telling me, "Hey, Daddy, that's an old man's, you know, game. So you better, you know, playing better game as we do." So today, I want to show you on a illustration. Now you see a peacock feather on my hands. I had to, you know, kill a peacock to, you know, get this here. I'm just joking. I paid, you know, $2 to, you know, get this on online. So when I'm balancing, you know, this on my hands, looking at the palm, right, it just keeps on pulling. Looking at my outlook calendar, it just keeps on pulling. So when I try to balance my schedule, looking up, looking at the tip, right? It quite works. Some wind blows from somewhere here. I try to balance it, just like keeps on falling this way. So this time, there will be spend some time this morning to focus on who we are in the Christ Jesus and reorganize our life and, you know, reprioritizing our life. And what is really important for us to do and what is, you know, needed in our lives so that we'll be focusing on our calling and be able to, you know, succeed, that, you know, we'll be the light of the world. So our passage for today is coming out of the book of John, chapter 3, verse 19 through 21. I have an NIV version. I'm going to read it to you guys one more time. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of the light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. I will say amen to this, right? We are talking about light. We, you and I, as a Christian, we are called to be a light to the world. But as you know, as I know, we are human beings. We can't really create the light. We need to be the reflection of the real light. That's obvious, right? We are like a moon. Moon doesn't have an ability to reflect of the light it's on. It takes the light from the sun and reflect onto the earth. When night comes, right, the moon appears. And then when sun appears, the moon disappears. But in the darkness, full moon really shine the road, and it allows everything to see. We are called to be the light. The reason why we called to be the light is, you know, Jesus came on earth to shine the world, right, as a light, because the world was in the dark. But how come we are the light of the world, and why does the world keeps on getting darker and darker? And now there's a problem. Maybe this author says this, you know, maybe the darkness doing its job, but it is the light not doing its job. Pretty much he's saying is like, we are called to be the light, but we haven't done that job yet as a light. Why is a Christian losing their light? We haven't done that job yet. The word is a value came into the Christianity, and it's, you know, influenced the Christianity, not only Christianity, but also each person's life. The reason why we can't shine, we are not shining the word because of things called sin. S-I-N. You guys know what in the middle of the sin? In the middle of the sin, I stand. Right? So when we live a sinful life, we cannot shine like a light. It is like in having a cliff. Sun is shining, but something is blocking the, you know, light. That's what we call sin. As God created you and I in the image of Him, He wanted us to be shine, but sin came in. It clouded everything. If you're looking at the story of Garden of Eden, God created a man first, right? And then later He created a man. He goes like, man, it's not good for him to be alone, right? So He puts him in sleep. And He was like, you know, man was in a prototype. And God said, I could do better next time. And instead of, you know, taking the dirt, this time He took the rib out of the man and created a woman. And then this man goes like, he was so impressed by, you know, God, and he goes like, whoa, man. That's how, you know, woman came in a woman. Oh, man, come on, you didn't get that? It's a high joke. Okay, so that is why woman has a lot more parts than man does. Because, you know, man made God in, and woman are man version 2.0. Amen. So God made her too smart. He wanted it more in her life. And she wanted something more than what she could find in the Garden of Eden. And all of a sudden, the evil spirit came to her, whispering on her ears and telling her, hey, there's a tree of knowledge, good and evil. If you eat the fruit from the tree, that tree, you're gonna be like God. And in other words, you know, you could take control of your life and even your destiny. You don't have to rely on God. You could be the God. How good is that? right? When we sin, like, the sin has a way of looking good, looking cool to us, but the end of result is the not that good. So when we sin, it becomes contagious. The Adam, according to the Bible, Adam was, you know, right next to the Eve. And she says to him, "Hey honey, bite this fruit. Very delicious. Trust in me. I know what I'm doing," right? This dumb man, you know, ate the fruit, right? So we have, you know, listened to the better versions all the time. But sometimes we gotta be careful. Better version has, you know, too much, you know, knowledge and too smart, right? So when do you want to, when do you need to listen to your, you know, better version right next to you? Well, sometimes we kind of like, you know, Adam falls into, you know, temptation with, you know, better version. And as they sinned together, they were going to hide themselves from God. That's what sin causes us to do. When we want to get away from God, is it when we feel like very spiritual? Or when we like receiving, you know, such a blessing from God? No. We want to run towards God, but the time that when we want to run away from God is when we sin against Him. So Adam and Eve, after they sinned against God, what did they do? They hid. And then God came in. God was telling them, "Hey guys, where you guys at? Odisop, where are you guys?" And Adam and Eve came out, and they said, "Oh, we were so afraid." And God told them, "Who told you to be afraid?" And they were saying, "We were naked. We felt shame." And God said, "You know, you've been naked." You see, sin causes us to feel the shame and causes us to hide ourselves from God. Anyone knows, you know, what early prayer meeting is? Like, if you are Korean American, you know what I'm talking about. 새벽 기도. In Korea, people get up at like, you know, 6 in the morning and they cry out to God. They pray about their sin, right? They pray about, you know, what did they wrong. And one time, I was serving at the local church as a, you know, pastor, and I talked to, you know, my deacon, "Why we get up like 6 in the morning every day and pray, you know, every morning? It's too much." And he goes like, "Jesus did it, that's why." And I looked through the Bible and I didn't find like Jesus was praying, you know, every day. You know, Jesus did it once in a while, not every day. But when we pray, we confess our sin. We tell God what we did wrong. "God, with my mind, with my thought, with my hands, with my mouth, I sin against you." There's nothing we could, you know, wash away our sin except by the blood of Jesus Christ. Wash me clean, and that is what we need to do this morning. If we want to, you know, shine, if we want to be a, you know, light of the world, that's what we need to do. We need to come clean before God, and only way that happens is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, I want to introduce you, you know, two different men from the Bible. The first guy name is Samson. He is known for his, you know, strength and then long hair, pretty long hair, right? And he was to be a, you know, liberator. God wanted it to use him for his, you know, kingdom. So before he was born, his parents were told how to raise him with a Nazarite vow. "Don't cut his hair and don't make him drink alcohol. Make sure he don't touch the, you know, seed carcass," which means, you know, dead body. So Samson had to, you know, keep his vows. And his parents made sure that he kept those vows. According to, you know, Judges chapter 13, verse 5, it says this: "You will become pregnant and have a son whose head is never to be touched by a razor, because the boy is to be a Nazarite, dedicated to God from the womb. He will take the lead in delivering Israel from the hands of the Philistine. His mission was delivering God's people out of the Philistines' hand to free them. But in chapter 14 of Judges, there's a statement that he makes. This is who is supposed to be a liberator who was chosen by God to great things for our God. The first statement that comes out of his mouth was, I saw a woman. He saw a woman. What is wrong with seeing a woman? There's nothing wrong with it, right? But this woman is not an ordinary woman. She was an enemy's woman. But this guy said, I like her. I want to marry her because she was so beautiful to him and so hot to him. See, men's are kind of simple being. We move by what we see. If it is pretty, we go like, oh, pretty, right? And we lose our mind and everything thrown out the door. And time to time, I get to conversation with my young soldier in my unit. And I ask, who do you want to marry in the future? They said, well, sir, she has to be spiritual. She has to be such and such. But later on, when I saw them meet a woman, they are not spiritual. They don't have much up here, but they are pretty. Nothing that kind of idea is kind of permeated all over the cultures nowadays. So now people wants to look good, right? That's the goal of life. That's the things that people are pursuing nowadays. And Samson fell into that temptation. He was weak for a woman. And he goes to meet her and then marry her. And then one day he killed a lion on his way back. He sees the lion that he killed. And then from the mouth of a lion, there was a honey flowing from the mouth. Guess what he did? He eats that honey. He touched the dead carcass, which he wasn't supposed to. As a Nazarite, he made a promise. He just broke the promise. And then chapter 16 of Judges, one day Samson went to the Gaza and he saw a woman named Delilah. The Samson already married to Philistine woman. And then now he got so attracted by a girl's name, Delilah. This is his lifestyle. Delilah was given a mission of finding out where Samson's strength comes from. And she tried three times. And then first time and second time, it didn't work out. Pretty much, Samson lied to her. But third time, this dumb Samson tells the truth. No razor has ever been used for head, he said, because I have been a Nazarite dedicated to God from my mother's womb. If my head were shaved by the razor that never used, then I'm going to lose my power. And he just tells the truth to Delilah. And when he was sleeping, his head was shaven. And Delilah yells that Philistines are coming. And Samson gets up, trying to defend himself. But he didn't have the power. And he got captured by Philistine. Let me ask you a question here. Do you really think that his strength comes from his hair? I don't think so. It came from God. But Samson didn't take God's command seriously. God told him not to touch that carcass, but because he was hungry for temporary relief, temporary pleasure, he took God's command not seriously. What was the first thing that happened when he was captured by Philistine? They gouged out his eyeballs. If Samson's eyes were gouged out way in the beginning, he wouldn't have that fallen into temptation. But the entry of the temptation, the starting point of a sinful life was taken away as soon as he got captured by Philistine. My brothers and sisters, we really need to take serious about, you know, God's word and what he commanded us to do. In order for us to be a, you know, light to the world, right? There's a certain things that, you know, we gotta do in order for us to be a light to the world. And the second guy name is David. His nickname is a man after God's own heart. Wow, that's a great nickname, isn't it? I wish I had that, you know, nickname too. But I'm not that great as, you know, David. But he was, you know, so great. But God also, you know, really loves him. But, you know, on and on, he screwed up. When he sinned, he sinned, you know, major. But then, you know, why is he called, you know, man after God's own heart? We'll find out. So ever since he was young, he tended a lamb, right? And he's very known for, you know, knock out the, you know, big old guy named Goliath. Like when Israelites, you know, saw that, you know, big old guy, right? Everybody was, you know, telling each other, oh, he's way too huge. There's no way we could, you know, defeat him. But this little guy named David, he's the one who said, whoa, he's way too big. There's no way I can miss him. I'm gonna grab the rock and then swing it and then throw it at him. There's no way I can miss him because he's too huge. He trusts in God and he throws it at him and he knocked that guy out. And after he became a king of Israelites, one night in his, you know, balcony, he saw a woman like Samson there. The woman was, you know, bedding. According to the Bible, she was so beautiful. And her name was Bathsheba. You gotta be careful what I'm saying. Bathsheba. That's why, you know, her name was Bathsheba. You didn't get it either? Oh, come on, church. This is a joke. Anyway, she was taking a bath, and then to David's eye, she was so attractive. And she was also married to, you know, a guy named Uriah, one of the, you know, great devoted general to King David. Her husband was, you know, fighting for his country and fighting for, you know, King David at the time. And David called Bathsheba to his palace because he liked her. And he has an affair. Unfortunately, she got pregnant with, you know, a child of David while Bathsheba's husband was fighting at the battlefield. How bad is that? It's horrible. To cover his affair, you know, he called Uriah back to the rear side. And he goes like, hey, you've been fighting good for, you know, me, so I'm going to give you a reward. Why don't you go to your home and spend the night with your wife? And as he is doing something, you know, wonderful to his devoted, you know, general, but he wanted to cover up his sin. That's what sin causes us. We want to cover up our sin. We are thinking we could cover it up. But there is no way we could, you know, fully cover that up. No way. But General Uriah, instead of, you know, going to home, spend time with his wife. He spent time with his servant and his soldiers because he was devoted general. Now, there is a no way David could cover up his sin. So guess what he did? He sent the general Uriah to the very front line of the, you know, battlefield, and he got killed. Wow, that's the David. Man after God's own heart. He's committing such a, you know, great sin. Later, you know, a man named Nathan, the priest, came to David, and he was telling him what David had done wrong. According to 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1 through 5, it says, there were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of lambs and cattle. But the poor man had nothing except one little female lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now, a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep and cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had to come to him. Instead, he took the female lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him. David burned with anger against the man and says to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this must die. He must pay for that lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity." David gets mad. He was so upset by hearing this, and he goes like, you know, he should be punished and killed. And then the priest Nathan, "Hey buddy, that is you. Guess what, you know, David did." Nathan goes like, "You have so many women around, but took away one lamb, one woman that was your faithful servant." And David falls on his face. He begins to cry out. He begins to, you know, repent what he did. In Psalm 51, I don't know if it is on an old song that, you know, Keith Green sang, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me." David is waiting on his pillow and cry out to God how sorry he was. He's repenting his sin. He's repenting his sin before his God, asking God, "Do not throw me away." Asking him, "Cast me not away from thy presence. Restore unto me the joy of your salvation." Once again, because he doesn't want to be cast out by God. And he doesn't want him to, you know, throw him away. That's the reason why God loved, you know, David. He screwed up, but every time he screwed up, he came back to God, asked God for forgiveness. Just like, you know, Samson and David, we sin because we are sinners. Every time we are good at something, the word "er" at the end of noun describes what we are good at. Teacher, they are good at teaching. Right, engineer, they are good at building something. And designer, they are good at designing. Sinner, as you and I, we are good at sinning. You and I are expert sinner, according to Romans chapter 3, verse 23. It says, "For all have sinned, and we all fall short of the glory of God. But by the grace of God, we have been redeemed and saved, and we be made a child of God." God adopted you and I as his children. But there's a deep inside of us, you know, we all have garbage, skeleton, and dirt. As long as we have those, we can't be the light of the world. But God will not abandon us, will not forsake us or leave us. Because we are his. We are his possession. He paid a big to bring us into his family. All we need to do is come back to him and ask for his forgiveness. You know, we all know that, you know, parable of, you know, prodigal son. It clearly describes, you know, who God is to us and who we are to him. The prodigal son's, you know, father, he had two sons, first and second. But second one, he took the, you know, possession from his dad while his dad was, you know, still alive. You know, if I was his father, I said, come here and I'll beat him up. I'm not giving, you know, any possession to him, because I was still alive. But this father was way too gracious to him, way too mercy. And he gave it to him, and his son took the money, went to the, you know, different country, spent it all, and became a, you know, poor man and homeless person. And now he's thinking, should I go back to my father's house? And according to the Bible, when he came to his sense, you know what that means? That is what we call, you know, repentance. Repentance is a change of our direction. We were going this way, right? And then we realize, oh, this is not the way, you know, God wants me to be. Then we repent, change our direction to, you know, where God wants us to go. That's what we call, you know, repentance. When this prodigal son came to his sense, he turned around and went to father's house, not expecting much. What did his father do? Ever since this son left his house, his father was waiting for him to come back. As his son comes to his eyesight, this father ran into his son. If you guys understand, you know, Jewish culture, that is unimaginable. Because as an old man, senior citizen, running is, you know, unimaginable. But the father was, you know, running towards his son. Brother and sisters, this is, you know, our Heavenly Father. This is what our Father is going to do to us if we come back to him. He's going to open his arms, you know, wide out, and then embrace us if we come back to him. As we come clean before him, as we become honest before our God and be transparent, we don't have to hide anything. Now, shame in the admitting our sin. No shame in admitting our sin, because we are all sinners, and God knows that. Unless we clean our vessel, God cannot use us as a light. But God will use us any kind of vessel. God will use big jar, small jar like me, and weird jar, cracked jar, and ugly jar, and he will use all kinds of jar. But there's a one jar that he will refuse to use. That is dirty jar. So I'm going to challenge you this morning, as we going back to our, you know, normal life. Every day, we need to come before God and ask for forgiveness. God, I have those, you know, bad habits. God, I sin against you. With my thought, with my mind, with my hands, with my mouth, I sin against you, Lord. Would you please cleanse my heart? Would you please forgive me one more time? Now God is calling us to be a light of the world, and only way for us to shine is for us to come before God, ask him to remove our sinfulness, to cleanse our heart, to be right before him. That's my challenge for you and I as we going back to our normal life. Let's pray together. Father God, what we call sin, no matter how many years we've been past, it is, you know, still sin call. So many people call what used to be sin, now it is lifestyle. God, no matter what we call in our eyes, there is a sin transgression. Lord, will you forgive us? Will you make your presence dear to us? As we come close, the light that all our blemishes, all our dirt, and all our shame will be revealed. Your purpose of calling the sinner to come, repent, is not to punish us, but to forgive us. It's not to blame us, but to restore us. Lord, we need confessing our sin before you. Forgive our sin and restore us to be your light of the world. And we love you, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand with me for our final hymn. We are going to sing hymn number 605, Living for Jesus, and we're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
The Lord has bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. Have a great Sunday afternoon.